You are too funny. You are something.
It's a cantaloupe.
Oh, man.
Oh, wow. Would you look at the time? Sorry, I gotta go. It's very nice meeting you. Thank you so much, everyone, for that warm welcome. Didn't expect to become so popular after just one episode. Welcome to our second episode of SciTV. In this episode, we'll be giving some students hard at work a study break, and we'll be talking to Professor Diane Lipscombe about her research. But first, I want to talk a little bit about the open science movement. When we think about science, we might think about competition. The space race, decoding the genome, the Apple versus Samsung debate, to name a few. But science doesn't have to be a competition. In fact, many people feel that science makes the most progress and is done most efficiently when we practice science openly. The open science movement seeks to democratize science and make it as accessible as possible. Different groups have different ideas about what this can mean. Perhaps it means making all raw data available for other scientists to use, or making scientific journals free to read, or open sourcing code for different computer programs. Basically, with open science, there are no secrets. It looks at scientific endeavors as collaborations for the greater common good, rather than individualized journeys to success. The first step towards making science more open actually came in the 1600s, when England and France established scientific academies. With these academies, and journals following closely after, science became more of a collaborative and shared endeavor. There was a sense that scientists were stronger when they shared their work with each other. Still though, this version of open science was limited to people with enough money and education to even practice science in the first place. With the internet making information so easy to access, there has been a huge push in the last 10 years to make science data available to everyone. In 2008, it became law that all journal articles associated with the National Institute of Health, or the NIH, be free to read. In 2011, a law was passed mandating that all federally funded science research data be made publicly available for anyone to view. Data can be made publicly available in this way using something called a data repository. Some of the largest of these repositories have cool names like Figshare, or Zenodo, or Dataverse. Brown itself has a data repository called the Brown Digital Repository, or the BDR. I sat down with Andrew Creamer, Brown's Scientific Data Management Specialist, and Hope Lappin, Brown's Scholarly Resources Librarian for the Biomedical and Life Sciences, to learn more about it. Although the name isn't as cool as some of the others, the BDR is an amazing resource, with curated collections of research, archives of almost 10 years of theses and dissertations, and so, so much data that can be viewed and used by Brown students and faculty alike. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Interview with a Scientist, the SciTV segment where we learn about science from people who actually know what they're talking about. We have with us today Professor Diane Lipscombe, Professor of Neuroscience and Director of the Brown Institute for Brain Science. Professor Lipscombe, thanks so much for being here with us.
Yeah, thanks for the invite. First off, you can call me Diane, please.
Diane, okay. Diane, thank you so much for being here with us. So can you tell us a little bit about the research that you do?
I'm interested in how calcium moves from outside to inside excitable cells.
Calcium, the calcium from milk.
Like the calcium from milk. I have this periodic table, which is my signature slide. It's all calcium. That's how much you care about calcium. That's how much I care. So there are proteins that are embedded in the membrane, particularly called excitable cells. And I study those proteins. They're called calcium ion channels because they are highly selective for the movement of calcium.
Can you tell us about the impact of this research on the public on a larger scale?
Morphine is a drug that acts through a receptor to regulate the activity of the channels that I'm interested in the pain pathway. Calcium channel blockers that lower blood pressure, they were kind of the first generation of antihypertensives. They inhibit the proteins that
antihypertensives.
There are a number of different drugs that are really owe their action to acting on these channels that I work on. So that's number one. Number two, a lot of disorders, mental health illnesses, schizophrenia, autism, and a number of other disorders that are more rare, like Timothy syndrome, that owe their the symptoms and the disease mechanisms are based on mutations that arise in the calcium ion channels.
According to my notes here, you are British.
Yes.
So I have to ask, who does better science, the Brits or the Americans?
This is a country of immigrants.
Uh-huh.
Our labs are filled with people from all over the world, and that's fantastic, and it's really exciting. So I have people in my lab who are from Argentina, from Mexico, China, Germany. I'm Scottish, but yes, British.
Uh-huh.
And so this is incredible collection of global contributions from people all over the world. That's what makes science great. And that's what
that's
makes
great to hear.
The United States great.
I agree. I very much agree. That's all the time we have. Before you go, I got you a gift, Diane.
Is it calcium?
I could go get some milk at the Ratty, but here you go.
Thank you.
For you. That's a brain.
That's amazing. Thank you. It's a brain?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Professor Lipscombe, Diane, thanks for being with us.
Thanks, Ben.
Let's be honest. School is hard. We've all had those days, or nights, or day-night combos where we don't do anything but study. And the Science Center certainly provides ample opportunity for that. But we also know that sometimes you just need someone to help you take a break. So we have with us today a bunch of hard workers. And the task at hand is you are going to race around the Science Center. First one back gets a prize. There's one more thing that we're going to add to make it a little more interesting. You have to yell out elements from the periodic table. If you are not yelling out elements, you guys can't do well with them, all right? Or else that's cheating. So make sure they're yelling out elements. That's your fuel to move. Ready? Okay. On your marks. Get set. Go!
Oxygen, nitrogen. Okay. And the winners are...